introduce our special guest, I'd like to ask Brother Hamma to give us a short running recitation, inshallah.
أعوذ بالله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين قالوا ربنا عليهم الملائكة تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون نزلا من غفور رحيم ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا وقال إنني من المسلمين ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله إنه هو السميع العليم صدق الله العظيم
JazakAllah khair, Brother Hamma, for that beautiful recitation. And now to introduce our special guest named Mufti Liaquat Zaman. Now, Mufti Liaquat Zaman is a teacher of Quranic, Arabic, Quran, Tafsir, and a well-known Asufa Institute here in Aston, in Birmingham. Now, Mufti Liaquat Zaman studied in Pakistan for around 9 years, if I'm correct. And he taught there, and now he teaches regularly at Asufa Institute with Sheikh Zahir Mahmoud. And he teaches Arabic, Tafsir, and Quran. Now I'd like to introduce Mufti Liaquat Zaman to start his talk entitled The Background. JazakAllah.
Okay, so Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala ashrafil anbiya al-mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Okay, just two things I want to clarify that brother said. I'm not special. Okay, I wish I was. And the second thing, I was not named Mufti Liaquat Zaman. I was named Liaquat Zaman. And you guys called me Mufti, so. Okay, so the talk today is about the heart. Yeah. Raise your hands if you got a heart. Yeah. Raise your hands if you got two hearts. Yeah, no. How many got two hearts? Well, that's wrong, guys, because the Quran clearly says, "Ma ja'ala Allahu fi jawfi qalbayni min jawfi rajulin." Allah has not placed two hearts inside of the body of one man. The women can have two hearts because they might have a baby, isn't it? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this, the sentence, he says, مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ فِي لِرَجُلٍ فِي قَلْبِهِ مِنْ جَوْفِهِ مِنْ
مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ فِي جَوْفِهِ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ
مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ فِي جَوْفِهِ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ Allah has not placed for any man in his body two hearts. But he has for a woman, because when she's having a baby, there's two hearts, her heart and the baby's heart. So you put your hand up, brother. You got to prove you got two hearts now, or you're sitting in the wrong place. Okay, so the heart is something very strange. I was thinking to myself, how can I explain to them what the heart is like? Is the heart like a driver of a car? Or is the heart like, you know, pilot of a plane? Or is the heart like the chef in the house? What's the heart? So the best example I can give was when I was 8 years old. So I always wanted a kitten. Yeah, you know, everyone, when they're kids, they want a kitten or a puppy or a bird or something. They don't want to take care of it. Yeah, the mom has to take care of it at the end of the day, but they want it. So my dad had a friend and he had Persian kittens. Anyone know what a Persian kitten is? Yeah, so these Persian kittens are very expensive, aren't they? So one of them costs about £250, just one cat. And so he gave us free. So he gave us a little small one, we call the cat Polly. Yeah, all our cats are called Polly, by the way. So if one dies or gets lost, they bring another one, that's the new Polly days. And they do the same things as well. So Ajib, you know, our cat, it actually goes toilet in the toilet or in the bath. Yeah, so you know, it actually sits on the toilet, it spreads its four legs out, and it just does it there, right in the toilet, and no one's taught it. And sometimes it goes in the bath, which I hope no one's taught it that. But this cat, it was, you know, just crazy cat this was. So as soon as we brought it home, me, my sisters, my brothers, we all jumped on the top bunk, you know, bunk beds. And this cat was just meowing at us, and we didn't know what the cat wanted. We thought the cat wanted to eat us or something. Yeah, we thought the cat wanted to scratch us because it kept jumping on us. So we were scared. So then my dad came home later and he saw the cat. He said, "You guys never had a cat before?" So he fed the cat. He said, "The cat's hungry." So anyway, we didn't like the cat anymore. So we got rid of it. So why do I mention this story? It's because, you know, the heart is exactly like an untamed animal. That's what it's like. You can't control your heart. Try your best to control your desires. You try your best, but the thoughts that come into your mind, the desires that you have, even the love that you have for a person, is uncontrollable. This is why the Prophet ﷺ, he said to Aisha, he said in the hadith that, "Oh Allah, I have tried my best to be equal amongst my wives, but with Aisha radiallahu anha, I can't control it." In other words, I can't control my love for Aisha radiallahu anha. It's because the Prophet ﷺ, even his heart, he didn't have control for the love that the people he had. So going back to the issue again, the heart is very difficult to define. What is exactly the heart? Even the ulama, they actually differ exactly what is the heart. See, there's two hearts. There's the physical heart, right, which, you know, pumps blood around the body. And there's another heart, the spiritual heart. And scholars differ exactly where the spiritual heart is. Is it the same heart, the organ that Allah mentions in the Quran, that Allah has not given a man two hearts in his body? Is it that? Or is it referring to something else? So Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he used to say that the heart, when Allah refers to qalb in the Quran, he actually refers to the place in the front of the head. So he said that place is called the qalb, the place where you think. And other ulama say, no, it's actually ma fi sudur, it's actually that which is in the chest. So the heart is, what we're talking about today is actually the spiritual heart. And that heart is something which becomes ill, like the Quran mentions. And it's very interesting how it becomes ill, because when your body becomes ill, what tends to happen is you begin to see symptoms of illness. Yeah, last night I ate at this place, I shouldn't have ate there. And in the morning, yeah, I had symptoms of bad stomach. Yeah, I had to go to the toilet about 2-3 times. And all morning my stomach was in pain. And that was because I had a stomach bug. But the heart is a bit difficult, because you can't simply just check yourself out and say, right, you know what, my heart's messed up. I've got a bad heart, I've got an ill heart. You can't do that. But the Quran, it gives us different types of heart. One of the types of hearts that the Quran mentions is qalb mutma'inna. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, "Oh Allah, can you show me how you bring the dead back to life again?" Because this is something that all of us believe. All of us believe that we're going to die one day, right? And our death is something that none of us can escape. Yeah, all of you guys sitting here, I know how much you guys love the dunya, yeah? And I love the dunya as well. But we all have to die one day. And death is imminent. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. But the reality is that we don't want to leave this world. You don't want to leave this world. And the heart, on the other hand, the heart that Allah Ta'ala has given us, the spiritual heart, this actually remains. Yeah, the physical heart might die away, but the spiritual heart, it remains even after we die. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Rabbi arini kayfa tuhyil mawta." Now it's interesting, when we were studying tafsir, studying this verse, we were studying under one of our teachers, and the book that we were studying was called Jalalain. Any of you guys heard Jalalain? Yeah? Any of you heard tafsir? Sometimes, you know, my wife, like, I teach my wife, and so she's qualified now. So last year she qualified. So the good thing about, if you've got someone who's studying the same thing as you, you can crack kind of same kind of jokes. Yeah, Arabic grammar jokes and crack with her, she gets it. But like everyone else in the house doesn't get it. Like, what are you guys on about? Yeah, so we can crack our own jokes, like jokes in usul hadith or jokes in usul fiqh. We can say to each other, Yeah, this is khas, this is aam, this is makhsus min hul ba'd. And we'll get it. Well, you guys will get no one. But we get it. So, Jalalain is a tafsir book, right, which is actually written by two scholars. One of the scholars, his name was Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. He was in the 9th century. Now, Jalaluddin Mahalli, he actually started his tafsir. And his tafsir is very brief. It's not like a big, massive tafsir. All he does, like, he mentions a verse and then he'll just say, like, خلق الإنسان أي الله, meaning Allah created man. So all he'll do, he's adding a few words like in the brackets. That's all he'll do. But the tough thing about the tafsir isn't trying to understand the brackets, it's trying to understand what is he on about sometimes. Because he goes into sometimes into Arabic grammar, and sometimes he goes into, you know, he even goes into astronomy sometimes to explain certain things. So anyway, he wrote this tafsir. So he actually started from Surah Al-Kahf right to the end. He completed it. And then like about 100 years later, another Imam came. His name was Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. Right, you heard of Imam Suyuti? Well, his full name or his nickname was Jalaluddin Suyuti. So he actually looked at the book. Oh, mashallah, amazing book. But unfortunately, the author died because he started from Surah Kahf. He went all the way to one Nas. He came back to Surah Fatiha and he died. He finished Fatiha, he died. So you got like Baqarah left, Surah Baqarah all the way up to Surah Kahf. So he came along and he began to write, trying to, you know, complete what he'd written. So that's why it's called Jalalain, because the two Jalals wrote it. Yeah, Jalaluddin Mahalli, Jalaluddin Suyuti. So anyway, what was I saying? When our teacher was explaining this verse to us, you know, I'm going to go off tangents, okay? Yeah, when I do talks, I just go off tangents sometimes. Once, you know, there was a scholar, yeah? And what the scholar used to do, whenever he used to give a talk, he used to always bring his talk back down to the same point again. Yeah, so the mosque got fed up of him. Yeah, because everything he used to talk about, he used to go all the way back down to, it was a certain Sahabi he used to go down to. Yeah, a certain Sahabi, he became Shaheed, so he talked about him. So the mosque got fed up. So what the mosque then, they'll actually tell them what's the verse before it. But I can all say to you, you know the ayah in the Quran, Inna Allah ala kulli shayin, you all might will say to me, ala kulli shayin qadir, isn't it? What's before that? Yeah, you all know you. So anyway, there's actually a madrasa in Pakistan where I was. And that madrasa, he actually teaches them their hifz in such a way that they can read any ayah before and any ayah back. So that when they test them, they'll say to them, okay, Wallahu khalaqa kulla dabatin. And then he says, okay, what's before that? He says it. What's before that? He says it. What's before that? It's not going to help you in Taraweeh, by the way. You've got to read forward. So anyway, where this verse is in the Quran, Allah says, just before that, there's two stories Allah mentions. Now one of the stories is this. Allah says, it starts off. He says that, أَنَّا يُحْيِي هَذِهِ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. There was a man, and he just said, أَنَّا يُحْيِي هَذِهِ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. How is it possible? Anna is useful like when you're kind of amazed at something as well. So you don't use kaifa, use anna. Anna yuhi. He saw this dead animal, yeah, and his village that was destroyed. And he said, how is it possible that on the day of judgment, Allah can bring all of these back to life? Yeah. So what did Allah do? Allah gave him death. 100 years went by. His animal that he was on, it died and decayed and rotted away. And then Allah gave him life again. And then Allah showed him with his own eyes how the animal came back to life. So then at the end he said, وَأَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَكُلِ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Now Allah doesn't mention his name. The next story after that immediately is very similar in theme. Allah says to Ibrahim, Ibrahim says, رَبِّي أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Oh Allah, oh my Rabb, please show me how do you bring the dead back to life. Now look at the difference between the two questions. The first one is what? Is more of a rhetorical question, isn't it? Anna yuhyi hadi illa ba'd mawtiha. And the other one is, Rabbi, oh my dear Lord, arini, please show me, kaifa tuhyi al-mawta, kaifa, not anna, how do you bring the dead back to life? So Allah, because he liked the question so much, Allah wanted to show mankind of how you should ask Allah questions, how you should supplicate to Allah. Yeah, so the first man, he doesn't mention his name, but the second person, he mentions his name, Ibrahim alayhi salam, because the question was so good. And this is also teaching us as well, when we deal with issues in our religion, we have etiquette for it, we have respect, we have mannerisms as well. You know, even dealing with Amro as well. Yeah? Assalamu alaikum, the text. Yeah? I hope you're well, brother. Yeah, so mashallah, you know, having these etiquette is very good as well. It's a part of our Islamic upbringing, our tradition. That's how scholars used to, you know, speak with one another as well. They should have respect for each other. So anyway, going back to this. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he asks Allah, كَيْفَ تُحْيَ الْمَوْتَى? How do you bring the dead back to life? Bringing the dead back to life, the physically something can be dead, and spiritually something can be dead as well. So this is why Imam Malik rahimahullah, in the Muwatta, he mentions that Luqman al-Hakim, he was a very famous person, Luqman al-Hakim, he was actually African. Luqman al-Hakim was, in first thing say, African Ajiba. In the Quran, a person who, if you think about it, at that time, before the advent of Islam, Africans were kind of looked down upon, racially they were looked down upon. But Allah mentions in the Quran the story of an African man who was not even a prophet, because of the qualities he had inside of him. And this is what me and you need to really relate to, that Allah, it doesn't matter who he chooses to be a prophet or who he chooses to become a role model for us, end of the day, it's the qualities that Allah looks for in people. And this is why, you know, there was a guy, his name was Mu'idi. Have I told you the story of Mu'idi? Have I told you? You guys haven't heard the story of Mu'idi? Okay. There used to be this king, right? You guys like stories, don't you? Yeah, my brother, mashallah, smiles when I tell stories. So there used to be this king. The king's name was Al-Mundir. So it was before Islam, before the advent of Islam. It was what we call a Jahili times, advent before Islam. Now the kings in them days, right, in the Arabian Peninsula, it wasn't like the kings today. The kings in them days were like autonomous. These were like people who just said and it was done. Right? If they wanted to destroy someone, kill someone, they just said it and it happened. They didn't have to go through, you know, some group of council or parliament or whatever. They just said it and it happened. That's why they were a bit mad as well. They used to go mad in the olden days. If you read about the kings in the olden days, they used to go a bit mad. They think God speaking to them. Anyway, it's not to you or anything. Yeah. So anyway, what happened is this. There was a guy called Mu'idi. Mu'idi was a raider. Yeah, you know what a raider is? Yeah, a guy that used to just go attack a village, rob, leg it. That's what he basically used to do. So what happened was this. This king was fed up of him. So what the king did, he put a ransom. Anyone who catches Mu'idi, I'll give him this much gold or this much sheep or whatever. And then there's sheep and gold, you know, and so on. Nowadays, what is it nowadays? Yeah. I'll give him a good job or something. Yeah, a nice car. So in them days, this was what the reward was. So after many months, many years, no one could catch him. The guy was still, you know, coming to Aston. Yeah, leg it. Grab someone's sheep, leg it. Grab someone's camel, leg it. So he got fed up, this king did. Anyway, eventually, this king, he wrote a letter to Mu'idi. And he hung it up. And he said on there, if you come to me, I will personally give you this many sheep, this many camels, this much gold, I'll give you everything. You just have to come to me. He goes, okay, right? So he came. So the king is sitting there. This short, skinny, dark man, he comes in. He walks in. And the king's looking at him, yes, who are you? I'm Mu'idi. So he said a famous statement that the Arabs use. He said, تَسْمَعُ بِالْمُعَيْدِي خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَنْ تَرَاهُ. Hearing about Mu'idi was better than seeing him. Yeah, you know, sometimes when you listen to a sheikh, like nowadays it doesn't happen because of Inna Lillah, because of YouTube. Everything's messed up because of social media. You know, I was thinking the other day, you know, on social media, you don't even miss anyone anymore. Missing someone was a ni'mah, wasn't it? Yeah, you used to miss your friend. There's like a guy on my Facebook, and I haven't seen him for about 1 year now. I hadn't seen him for about 2 years that time. So anyway, there was some issue, I had to go and meet him. I met him, he goes to me, yeah, you okay? I just brushed me off. I go, what's this? He goes to me, every day I see your posts on Facebook. So you know sometimes what happens, you hear this sheikh, you hear his talks, ah, subhanallah, this guy must be 6'5", this guy must, you know, bench press, you know, this 150, yeah? This guy must, you know, be able to pick up a car with his one hand, and he comes in the room, It looks like me.
It happens, isn't it? Yeah, so that's what Arabs say. Tasma'u bil mu'aydi became like a saying, a proverb. Yeah, tasma'u bil mu'aydi khayran min antarahu. Hearing about mu'aydi is better than seeing mu'aydi. Okay, anyway. So he listens, this guy was listening, and then his chance came to speak mu'aydi. He said something very powerful. In the olden days, let me tell you, you know, thieves. Yeah, thieves, crooks, bandits, raiders, whatever you want to call them, they were good people in the olden days. They used to do bad, don't get me wrong, but they were good people. They had respect, they had morals, they had principles. Yeah? So, you know, there was this Somalian brother, we were studying in Madrasa, there was loads of Somalians there. Somalians and Pathans are everywhere in the world. Yeah? Trust me, you pick up a stone and you find Somalians and Pathans. So you find them everywhere. I was shocked in Karachi where I studied. There's actually a whole community of Somalians, so many that the mosque has to have a separate dars for them. That the mosque had to have a separate dars because they were everywhere. So anyway, so this Somalian guy came to me, goes to me. He's an amazing guy, very good guy, mashallah. And he said to me, he goes, you know, in our country, you know, the thieves, he goes, this is how the thieves are. He goes, a guy stopped a guy on the road, and he said, give me your money, you got a gun and everything. He goes, give me your money. He said, okay, yeah, no money. He goes to him, are you Hafiz? The driver goes, yeah, I'm Hafiz. Read Quran as well. So he goes, start from here. So he goes, okay. So he started reading, he made a mistake, he hit him. He goes to him, you're a Hafiz, astaghfirullah, you're a Hafiz of Quran. And you're making mistakes in the Quran. Don't do that again. So they used to have principles. They were like good people. They had understanding. Nowadays the thieves, they're thick. Sometimes you see someone, you know, sometimes like on Facebook, like you see someone put a video of some thief that gets caught and he gets beaten up in the shop or something. And you're like, thick this guy is. Yeah. And like, you know, some guy, he beats someone up on the street. He gets caught a few days later by the police. Because they got cameras everywhere. Yeah, at least cover your face. Like that one guy in America, you know, he went to rob a bank and he rubbed a permanent mark on his face. He thought they can't catch him. And another guy, what he done was, I don't know, he put banana peel on his face or something, thinking that it makes him invisible to the cameras. It's a little bit thick, aren't they? Yeah, nowadays, in the olden days, they were good people. You can actually get books that are written about these kind of thieves, stories about them. Anyway, so what happens is this Mu'aydi, when his chance comes, right? He says, let me just tell you two things. He goes, la yukalu rijalu bihada. Men are not measured in this way. Innama yukalu rijal bihada wa hada. Men are only measured by this and this. And that king was shocked. Because that's true, that is. You only truly know the true status of a person if you do what? If you look at what kind of speech they have, if they're true in their speech, and if they're loyal in their hearts. And this is why the ulama say the Quran was revealed to the Arabs. Because even though they were known as bandits, yeah, they were known as thieves and robbers killing each other, but they had certain qualities which qualified them for receiving the Quran. And you need to have certain qualities. This is why just learning etiquette from him, 30 years, imagine that. You have how many years you guys been here? Yeah? 2 years, 3 years, 4 years? Some guys, 5 years, 6 years. Still living the year again. There used to be this one guy in it. There used to be this one guy in the madrasa. He was the security guard. Yeah? That guy had been, I went there 2000. So, that's the security guard. Are you okay? Yeah, I'm okay, mashallah. So I asked my friend, you know, the security guard, he's a good guy in it. He goes, you know, the security guard, he's been working here for 20 years, mashallah, 20 years, subhanAllah. He actually first came to study. He studied the first year, he failed. God, you repeat, he repeated the first year again, he failed. 7 times he repeated the first year. Eventually the headmaster goes, look, we'll give you a job. Become a security guard. So since that day he's been a security guard. Yeah, so you guys, you know, at Aston University, you're a security guard or you can get a job, inshallah. So anyway, so where did I reach? See, you guys are not awake. So anyway,
So this Mu'idi, these were two things. And the Quran, like I said, was revealed to people that have qualities. Imam Abdullah Mubarak, he stayed in the company of Imam Malik for how many years?
30 years.
You know, in them days, there were two types of students used to get. Nowadays, you get loads of types of students. The guy that comes late, the guy that copies notes from his friend all the time, the guy that goes to sleep in class. You know who you are, guys. Yeah? I used to have a friend in my class, honey. That guy was just messed up, man. He used to come in class, used to sit down, and he used to go to me, are you okay? Oh, yeah. He used to get like a scarf, he used to borrow my scarf, and he used to go, can I use this? Oh, yeah. He used to put his head down, he goes, tell me when the teacher goes, puts his head down, knocked out, all the way through, and he passed the exam as well. Yeah? Because you guys know you don't have to attend class technically, yeah, to pass the exams. All as long as you can catch up on all the work, then you're okay usually. So in them days there were two types of students. One type of student was a student who used to study to gain knowledge. And there was another type of student used to have that used to just go to the teacher just to benefit, to become a better person. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they used to say, how many people are in your class? How many people in your lectures?
Up to 120.
120, yeah. You know, in our class, yeah? Our last class, we had 550 people in the class. And there are so many people that I worked out, if I was every day to meet one person and shake his hand, yeah, I would need about 1.5 years to meet everyone. Just to shake one person's hand every single day. And eventually, like in the last day when we were finishing, there was about 200 guys who I had not even met the entire year. That's how many guys we had. So Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he actually had 2,000 people coming to his gatherings. 2,000. 500 came to study knowledge from him, and 1,500 just came to look at his face. I don't mean look at his face because, you know, you can see his face. He's got a nice face. Just to look at his face, meaning to benefit from him, to sit in his company. Yeah, you can imagine like them days with no microphone or anything. People coming to listen, to be attentive. And this is why these are etiquette from our religion as well. You know, like Allah says in the Quran, إِلَّا مَنْ أَلْقَ السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. You know, in lesson, you're awake, you're listening attentively to what the teacher says. So your Abdullah ibn Barak, he says, 30 years, I did what? Yeah, I benefited from the etiquette of Imam Malik. 30 years. And Imam Malik's class was a hardcore class, guys. Let me tell you, Imam. They used to compare the classes of Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Malik. Imam Malik was in Medina, and where was Imam Hanifa? Not in Pakistan, yeah, not in Aston. He was in Kufa. Kufa is in Iraq, today's Iraq. So he was there. And so, you know, Imam Abu Hanifa's gathering was just amazing, man. Like, the teacher used to walk by, and everyone's shouting. So one day, Imam Sha'bi walks by, and he calls Imam Hanifa. He goes to him, what's this? What kind of students have you got? They don't listen to the teacher, they're shouting in class. He goes, no, he goes, they're learning. He goes, this is how I teach. He goes, I believe that students learn when they interact with each other, when they question each other. So his lessons were all about questioning each other. They would question the teacher. The teacher says something, why do you say this for, why this? And he would question them. And that's how they would learn fiqh. This was a dynamic way of teaching fiqh. On the other hand, Imam Malik's lessons were like, you know, pin drop silence. Imam Malik had two gods, you know that. This is mentioned by Qadi Iyad in his book called he's got a book that's written biography on Imam Malik. I forgot the name now. So in there, he mentions Imam Malik had two bodyguards. You know what the bodyguards used to do? Yes, they used to kick people out of the mosque that used to mess around. He had two bodyguards for that. Because once this man came in the mosque, he took off his scarf, got his stick and slammed it on the floor. Allah! Imam Malik goes, grab him, kick him out. Yeah, finish his salat, they grabbed him, kicked him out. They go, this is the mosque of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Have respect, his grave is over there. Have respect for his grave. So he used to have two gods. So his lessons were like pin drop silent. You couldn't even ask a question because he might not even answer you. A man actually came from Andalus, Spain. Yeah, it's narrated that a man came from Spain and he came all the way. How far is Spain from Medina? How many miles? Anyone good at geography? Anyone good at using Google Maps? Yeah? It's over 1,000 miles, isn't it? Very, very long distance, okay? So this guy comes, obviously there's no plane, and there's no ships and all that. So this guy comes, you know, by foot or by whatever, all the way to Imam Malik, and he's got a whole list of questions he wants to ask his people. Have asked him, you know, can you go and ask this guy this question? So he asks Imam, a question. He goes, okay, right, Imam Malik, what's the answer to this? La adri, I don't know. No, you must know, man. He goes, no, I don't know. He goes, okay, next question. Well, what's the answer to this? I don't know. 40 questions he asked him. He said 36 of the questions, he said, la adri, I don't know. So the guy said to him, you're Imam Malik, the other side of the world, people think you know everything. He goes, well, they're wrong then. Yeah, this is the kind of humbleness he had. Yeah, humbleness he had. And Imam Malik used to say this statement all the time. He said, I fear on the day of judgment that the people, that I will enter Jahannam because the people are making me as a bridge for them to answer their questions. I don't have to answer anyone's questions. Yeah, but if I know the answer, I'll answer it. If I don't know the answer, I'll just say I don't know. So this was what Imam Malik rahimahullah was like. Etiquette they used to learn, they used to learn adab. And this adab, this etiquette, it makes you what you are. It makes you a good person. And this is why our Islamic tradition of learning knowledge is a tradition which doesn't just educate someone, doesn't impart just knowledge. Imparts also tarbiyah as well. Tarbiyah is very important when you're learning. If you look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you'll find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't used to just teach. He actually used to teach them manners as well. Everything he used to teach, he used to teach them with manners as well. Yeah, once there was a man and he was performing, you know, wudu, and the Prophet says, look, you know, be careful of how you're performing wudu. Because there's even extravagance in performing wudu. So the man said, there's extravagance in wudu. How can I be extravagant in doing my wudu? He goes, even if you're sitting at the banks of a flowing river, you can be extravagant in performing wudu. Now what did he mean by this? So the ulama say what he actually meant was that extravagance is a habit that you gain through other things. It's not just in wealth, you gain it in everything. Sometimes, for example, you know, you go to the shops and you think you've got a lot of money in your pocket. And then you think, oh, you know, I'll just buy this chocolate. I'll just try it. Oh, I'll just buy this drink, I'll try it. I'll buy this, I've got the money anyway. That can actually lead to extravagance. Because when you go home, you might not eat it. Chuck it away. So you're careful of how you use your money, how you use your time even, and everything. لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ صِرْفٍ أَصِرْفُ فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ ulama say. Everything has extravagance in them. So the Prophet ﷺ used to teach them. Sometimes the Prophet ﷺ used to get angry at the Sahaba. Yeah, once I was teaching kids, and yeah, kids, they make you angry. And, yeah, tell the truth. Yeah, I know upstairs says everything, but kids make you angry, man. You gotta have sabr, you gotta have patience. So once I was teaching the children, and the kids come out with, they're not shy of asking questions. Yeah, adults are shy of asking questions. You know why? Because you know what adults would do? They'll come with an anonymous kind of email. Sheikh, you said this. Ugh. And we ask, what's your name? Like, they don't want to say their name. Yeah, because they're shy of saying who they are. But kids not. So I was teaching the little kids one day. And I said, you know what? Allah has no children. Allah has no brothers, no sisters, no parents. So one girl goes, but is Allah bored? I said, why is he bored? He's got no kids. He's got no brothers and sisters. He must be bored. So I was thinking, frustrating. How am I going to explain to this kid that not having brothers and sisters for Allah is a good thing? That's actually tawheed. Yeah, and for us, it's a bad thing. So, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so I was teaching one day and someone came to me and a parent came to me and said, you know what? You shouldn't tell off children. I go, why? Because the Prophet ﷺ never told off any Sahabi. And then they quoted to me that, you know, that famous saying of Hassan ibn Thabit, that he never used to say La. And if it wasn't for Tashahud, you know Tashahud? You know Tashahud? At-tahiyyatu lillahi wa salawatu wa tayyibat, that's called Tashahud. He goes, if it wasn't for Tashahud, he would have never used La in his entire life. That's a bit of exaggeration. But he was just trying to prove the point that the Prophet ﷺ was not a rude person. You know, and this is also something which is good, that you don't make someone feel bad. So, لَوْلَ تَشَهُدِ لَمَا قَالَ لَا. If it wasn't for tashahud, he would have never said La. You know a story about La? You know a story about La, yeah? And it's not about Teletubbies or... Yeah, you watch the Teletubbies, huh? Okay, so Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was once in the masjid. So a Bedouin came in, and does anyone know Arabic here? I know some of you do. Like, can anyone understand Arabic poetry? classical Arab poetry.
Mustafa,
yeah? Mustafa, come on. You're gonna translate 100 couplets. You know what happened once? Well, I was in Pakistan.
Yeah, it's funny, man.
Disclaimer, guys. Just before no one laughs. It's funny. So when I was in Pakistan, this guy, and he goes to me, he goes, can you translate for me? He goes to me, can you give a talk? I go, I can give a talk, but I can give a talk in English. I can't give it Urdu, because I never used to know Urdu well in them days. I still don't know Urdu. But I never used to know it that well in them days. So anyway, so I go to him, okay. He goes to me, don't worry, I'll translate. Yeah, I'll translate everything you say. I know English. Is that okay? Got it okay? I used to have this friend and it reminds me. I can actually, if you invite me one day, I can give you a talk on just my friends. Yeah? You might have to stay all the way till Fajr, but trust me, it's gonna be good, man. So I used to have this friend and he used to have this small mirror. It was like a bit bigger than this. Yeah, it's a bit bigger than this. And we used to be sitting in class, and every like 5 or 10 minutes he'd be going. So I went, don't worry, you're not dead. You can look at your mirror outside. So anyway, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was in the mosque. A Bedouin walks in. So the Bedouin says this to him. He says, Wawun am wawani. What does that mean?
Wawun.
Everyone knows that, come on. Yeah, all you guys know that as well. Wawun, one waw or two waws? Wawun am wawani. So imagine someone just walks into the room and says, one more or 2 hours? Yeah, 2 hours of milk as well and fun as well. Yeah? So he says, wawun am wawani. So what he meant, wow means ant. Is it one ant or two ants? So the question had nothing to do with the lesson. This Bedouin, and Bedouins were very eloquent in how they used to speak. Because they used to get to the point. They don't like kind of, you know, go around the bush. Yeah, saying all these long things. And this is why, let me tell you something. You know, that's not funny. You're serious. You're serious. Listen carefully. So this is why, you know, what time? Yo, I've got so much marking to do. Oh, headache, man. You know what happened this week? I'll tell you what happened this week. You know, like, I mark homeworks, innit? So I teach the first year's part-time. So first year's part-time, you have, like, guys like you. University students, adults, I teach them. So we've got, like, I think it's about 40, 50 brothers and 50 sisters. So I've got to mark all their work every week. Imagine that. Yeah. I give them homework, and then I have to mark it. Obviously, I'm very sincere and all that. But, well, I mark all this work. So they always say to me, why do you give us so much work for it? So this week, what's happened is some of the guys, they've backdated all their work, and they've given me, like, 2 months of work. They're big piles. I've got to go through all of that. That's reminded me that you remember. So, let me tell you something about the Arabic language. You know the Arabic language, yeah? You know classical Arabic? You know why you need to learn that for the Quran? Is because the measure for Arabic language to be like amazing is when you can say something very long in the precise wording. If you can say something really, really long and just use the exact words, right, then your language is very good. You're considered to be eloquent in Arabic. You know sometimes when you're speaking to your friend and they go like, you know that thingy, yeah? Yeah? You know, I had that thingy the other day, and that thingy came down my house, you know, my yard, and you know, this. Yeah? So you're very general with your words. You're not precise with your words, and that's a sign that you're not very eloquent in being able to express yourself. But Arabs are excellent at expressing themselves. They have words for like mad things, you know. Things I've never heard of in English, they have words for that in Arabic. Like, for example, you know, in Arabic, they've got words like, you know, like different shaped eyes. Yeah, different shaped eyes, different shaped noses. They've got exact words for them. If the eye is long, if it's small, if it's big, if you've got big eyelashes, small eyelashes, if it's grey, if it's brown, if it's black, if it's all these different colours, if it's bloodshot eyes, if it's yellowness in the white part of the eyes. All these things, they've got exact words for it. There was a scholar, his name was Imam Ibn Sina. You're probably thinking, he started off with heart.
He's ended up somewhere else. Yeah, so there was a scholar called Imam Ibn Sida. Anyone know Imam Sida? He's not the Imam, the mosque down the road. Yeah, he was there about in the 5th century after Hijrah. He was a Spanish scholar. And he actually wrote a book, a dictionary. Yeah, and that dictionary, he writes a different dictionary. He writes a dictionary, like he starts off from the features of the body. And you know, every single part of the body, he has names for different types of them. Like if you've got a long beard, what is it called? Short beard, what is it called? Yeah, scruffy beard, what is it called? Neat beard, what is it called? Trim beard, what is it called? A beard that's out of control, what is it called? Yeah, if your beard's on the table, what is it called? Yeah, he's got this whole book, yeah, and it's a dictionary, and guess how many volumes it is? 10 volumes? And he's got another one that he's written as well. Two dictionaries, got both 10 volumes, and he was born blind. That's how precise these guys were in the Arabic language. They preserved the Quran, these people did. Preservation of the Quran was amazing. So anyway.
Wawun
and Wawani, yeah. So this guy comes in, yeah. Don't worry about that. Not you. Another guy comes in. And he says to Imam Hanifa, Wawun am Wawani. So Imam Abu Hanifa says, Wawani. So he goes, Barakallahu laka kama baraka fi la wala. What does that mean?
May Allah bless you the same way He blessed both of us.
La wa la. Yeah. May Allah bless you just as He blessed La and La. So, the students were amazed. What the hell's happened here? Yeah. Like, what's happening? Secret language or something? So, Imam Hanifa said, this guy just asked me a question. He said to me, in tashahud, do you say wow twice or do you say once? This is ikhtilaf of, you know, tashahud, there's various variations amongst the Sahaba. So for example, like At-Tahiyyatu Lillahi Was-Salawatu Wat-Tayyibat, 2 hours. That's the tashahud of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. And then there's the tashahud of Ibn Abbas, there is one waw, At-Tahiyyatu Salawatu Tayyibat, which has only one waw in there. So he said, he asked the question to me, that is tashahud 1 waw or 2 waws? And I said to him, it's 2 waws. He said to me, may Allah bless you like He's blessed La wa La. What does that mean? He goes, in the Quran Allah says, that shajaratun mubarakatun la sharqiyya wa la gharbiyya. That Allah has, you know, the olive tree that Allah has planted. But in such a place that there's no easterly shadow, nor does it have a westerly shadow. Like the sun's always beating down on it. That's like the best situation for a tree, best conditions. So this is what it was like. So anyway, right, what's the topic today? Heart, yeah? Okay, so now seriously. We have to understand that the spiritual heart is something that many of us are heedless of. Allah in the Quran mentions that on the Day of Judgment, when a person goes in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment, none of his actions, none of his deeds, none of his wealth, none of his children, nothing will benefit him on that day. Illa man atta Allah biqalbin salim. Except for a person who comes to Allah with a sound heart. What is a sound heart? Yeah, sound heart is something that will determine whether Allah accepts your salat. Sound heart is something that will determine whether Allah accepts your charity. Sound heart is something Allah will determine whether anything is accepted. You know, there was a Zaman, right? He went to the shop and he went to buy something. So in the olden days, you know, they used to have silver and gold currency, jewel currency, bimetal currency. So he gave the silver coins. So when the shopkeeper looked at these coins, he said, sorry mate, coins aren't accepted here. So the man immediately screamed out and he fell to the ground. So the shopkeeper, what the hell's happened here? This guy trying to put a scam on me. Insurance scam, yeah? So you know, insurance scams, guys. We all know insurance scams. There's a guy, I saw him and he went to the mosque. He had an accident. There's only one guy in the car. I swear there's only one guy in the car. I came back from the mosque, four guys. It's all down the road. Ambulance come to pick him up. Alhamdulillah. May Allah save us. You know, this isn't how we should live our lives. You know, deceiving people. So this man is knocked out. People are coming around him and asking him, what's happened? So this man, when he regains consciousness, the guy says to the shopkeeper, he goes, you know when you said to me that my coins are not accepted here, immediately I remembered on the Day of Judgment. Imagine I stand in front of Allah and Allah says, you know, all the actions you've done for me, they go in Jahannam. Go. Imagine that happens. Ajeeb, huh? This is called Ibra, this is. And Ibra, Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَإِبْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ. Yeah? Ibra is what? In Arabic, it's something that takes you from one side of the road to another side of the road. Al-Ubur. Because when you see something, immediately your mind goes towards something else. This is how a Muslim lives their lives. They're always reflective. They're always reflecting on anything that happens in their life. They always see lessons in them. So much so that Allah even teaches us lessons in an ant. Subhanallah. The ant in the Quran, you know, none of us would have ever seen any significance of animals if you truly think about it, if it wasn't for Allah mentioning insects and animals in the Quran. A scholar has actually written a book, and he was in the 8th century. His name is Al-Imam Dimyati. And he writes a book, it's called Hayatul Haywan Al-Kubra. A whole encyclopedia from Alif to Ya of animals. And in Spain, you remember when you went to Spain, that there was the Khalifa, one of the Khalifas that was there, he was the first person to establish a zoo in the whole of Europe. The first person to have a zoo. Where did he get the idea from? Because Allah goes into so much detail about certain animals in the Quran, about the bee, how the bee, you know, it creates its nest, its hive, the ant, and these insects, that we become curious about these things. We want to learn more about these things. Allah wants us to learn about these things. Yeah, that's where we get astronomy from.